Let us discuss ethnomethodology. This concept was founded and coined by Harold Garfinkel. In this theory and in this concept, we are going to study how ethnomethodology came into being and what are some of its characteristics. So, in layman terms, I can say that whatever is happening in our lives on a day-to-day basis, ethnomethodology aims to study that. The practical reasoning, the practical living. Because what happens whenever something happens in our life on a daily basis, we always do not think it in a logical way, but sometimes it's in a practical way. For example, if someone extends their hand to you, you automatically understand whether it is to hit you or whether it is to shake your hand. So this is what we gathered from our day-to-day experiences, from our practical living. So ethnomethodology studies that only. Now there's another term called phenomenology. So what is the difference between these things are? When the phenomenologists, they study on what people think, and in ethnomethodology, sociologists, they try to find out what people actually do. So this is the basic difference, and they try to examine the methods and procedures that are happening in the world and try to give meaning to it. So this is what is ethnomethodology, which is an approach to social inquiry and a theoretical perspective by which we understand what is happening in our daily lives. We give sense to it, we give it meaning. And Garfinkel talked about documentary method. In the documentary method, he has talked about how there are certain features of a situation. For example, when you enter your class, you will see the same features every day. The students talking to each other, sitting on the chair, maybe writing something, and all of these things. So you will understand, okay, the teacher is not there. And if there is a decorum in class, everybody is seated in a proper way, they are quiet and not talking, you will understand that yes, the teacher is there. Even when you cannot see the teacher, you will understand that the teacher is there. So therefore, there is always a hidden pattern, and we define this pattern, we find this pattern, and this pattern can be used as an evidence, which tells that this is an indication that we know what is happening, or we can predict what is going to happen. So we can say that there is a relationship between individual documentary evidence and what is known. So what we already know and the evidences or the pattern that are there in the environment around us, in the surroundings around us, there is a relationship between the two, by which we can understand what is happening and we can also give meanings to the things that are happening around us. One important point to notice here that this theory is not focused on actors or individuals, but the members as a whole in the society. For example, when we talk about Karl Marx, he has talked about a particular class. So that kind of a theory is macro in nature. And when we talk about Durkheim's theory of suicide, it talks about the role of actors or individuals. And that is the micro kind of a theory, microstructure. But ethnomethodology, it is neither focused on the microstructures nor on the macrostructures, but it is focused on what practices are there in the society that produce structures in the society, because it is interested in knowing what people, how people do things and what people do. This can be further understood by Atkinson's common sense theory of suicide, where he studied the coroners and understood that anybody can recognize the hidden pattern when there is a suicide. How come? You know, if you witness a suicide near your place, so you can understand that the method that is being used, the type of thing that was done, there can be some evidence like notes, life history, maybe that person was really unwell or frustrated or mentally unwell. So there is a definite pattern, and because of that pattern, we can understand by our common sense and by our experience that what has happened and why it has happened. Now, coming to the concepts of ethnomethodology, there are two concepts, that is indexicality and reflexive accounting. So when we talk about indexicality, it is said that there is no fixed meaning, and meaning can only be derived when it has some context. For example, when there is a suicide, no meanings can be gathered from the pattern, but only on the basis of some context, some evidence, only then we can find out the meaning. On the other hand, reflexive says that meanings are always set, and that is how we communicate. For example, when you go out to perhaps shop and you are just browsing through the clothes in the mall, and the salesman, he comes near you. So you know that he's coming closer to you because he wants you to buy something, and perhaps you will tell him that I'm just looking, or perhaps you will just turn your face and start moving ahead. So how do you know this? Because these meanings are set, and that is how we react, that is how we communicate. He has also used the term reflexively accountable. So accounting is, in sociology, it is the way by which people process and offer accounts in order to make sense of their surroundings or of the world. So what is this accounts? So these are nothing but the ways in which all the actors in the society, they explain, criticize, or describe things. So this process is known as reflexively accounting. And this accounting can be done only through thorough conversations and analyzing those conversations to know the whereabouts of the person, to get a detailed analysis. There's another term that we need to understand, and that is ethnomethodological indifference, where the ethnomethodologist, they analyze the accounts, that is whatever has been told by the actors, and they try to find out what is their practical use in the society, how it can be used, how anything that we think is common sense or that we have gathered through our experience, how we can make use of it in our practical lives. Garfinkel has also talked about the explanation of social order, and it has been said that the ethnomethodologists, they give credit to the members of the society, and they say that whatever is happening in the society, there is no fixed order, and it appears like so only because there are meanings attached to it, and the people around the society and whatever thing is happening, the people have given meaning to it, and only that is the reason which is why it is being recognized. So there is a stress and focus on the actors or the members of the societies. Their views of social reality are regarded as important. So this is also very much like the phenomenological approach, but I have already told you the difference. So how is this social order achieved? People create social order from the bottom up. So we experience something every day in our lives, and we experience it by the virtue of common sense knowledge. And the society exists only because the actors think it does exist. So if the actor stops thinking highly of the society, or he thinks that the society has no meaning, the society would eventually lose the meaning. He has called man as a cultural dope who acts in adherence or compliance to the directives of the society. So whatever the society has told, man acts according to that, and therefore, according to Garfinkel, he is a cultural dope. Society is also a social construction according to Garfinkel and the other ethnomethodologists. Why? Because we make sense of our everyday living, our everyday lives, through common sense knowledge and experience. Therefore, society is a social construction. It is our own construction. Now, let us move towards solving some questions. Which one of the following is correct about ethnomethodology? So the answer is going to be C, certainly not macro sociology. It can be taken into micro sociology, but it is not a microsociology, but according to the options given, it is certainly not macrosociology, as it is concerned about the structures and not the society as a whole. Second question, Garfinkel considers which of the following to be the fundamental sociological phenomena? Answer is B, treating the objectivity of social facts as accomplishment of members. But you need to know that here social facts are not the ones which were talked about by Durkheim, who said that social facts are external and constrained. Here social facts are what is achieved or accomplished by the members of the society. Next question. According to ethno-methodologists, which type of reasoning is used by the people? Answer is going to be C, practical reasoning, which is the use of everyday emotions, experiences and common sense knowledge. Thank you for watching.